I'm Austin from PopXCast, a pop culture podcast part of the Gunna Geek Network, just like the show you're checking out now. Shows on the network are individually owned and opinions expressed may not reflect others. Find other awesome geeky shows at GunnaGeekNetwork.com.
And welcome to another Creator Talk episode of Play Comics, where for the first time in probably months in recording, I am actually wearing pants. Which really doesn't have anything to do with anything at all, but I feel like that's an accomplishment right now.
That's cool, because I'm not.
Well, good. I'm glad only one of us is. That other voice you hear is Alex Schumacher. Alex, how are you today?
I'm well, Chris. Thank you for having me on.
We're here today to talk about your new book that just came out, Mr. Butterchips.
Yeah, that's the one.
So this is something I had seen on Twitter just from following you with stuff. But I'd seen, you know, the little clips that you put on Twitter. And then All of a sudden, hey, here's a book. So I'm like, cool, I have to go check this thing out.
Yeah, I'm glad you did. That was kind of the impetus, was to have some sort of, you know, physical product where all of those had been collected. And SLG Publishing, which is kind of a luminary in the alternative comics world, was kind enough to take me on and release the book for me.
So what was the process like for you taking this from a webcomic to a physical I can read in the bathroom book?
It was the idea that I wanted to collect all of them there. The comic debuted in April of 2016. So it's been going about 4 years by the time that I got the collection going. So it's April 2016 to April 2020. So it's about 45 individual comics that are collected. And so I knew I wanted to put those together, but I wanted something that would be incentive to actually buy the book, because you can read those comics online. So I had this idea to do a standalone story, which is about 22 pages long. It's just sort of an acid trip through San Francisco, and SLG was completely on board with it. So we went ahead and I produced that and got some pinups, some renditions of Mr. Butterchips from some gallery friends, a foreword written, some pull quotes, and the process took a few months to get that all together, but I think it turned out pretty well, and people seem to be pleased with the final product, so I'm pleased.
I'm really excited for when it comes out, because this is going to be basically a first time for me running through everything.
Oh, cool. Yeah, that's great. I mean, and that's sort of the, one of the demographics too, is people who have never read it can now have all of them in the palm of their hands.
So is this something you've been doing by yourself the entire time, or have you had help a little bit along the way?
As far as creating it, I started with the online magazine called Drunk Monkeys, and that sounds really contrived to put a Drunk Monkey comic on a site called Drunk Monkeys, but it was far more organic than that. And I knew the founder, a guy named Matt Garucki, and he invited me to do an ongoing comic for their site. So I had this character, this foul-mouthed little chimp that I decided to just go ahead and put in there and develop a little bit. So I have drawn, written, lettered that all myself. I was kind of given carte blanche by the site to talk about whatever I wanted, you know, tackle any subjects or issues that I wanted to. And it's just been going like that since, like I said, 2016.
One of the things I really liked about the earlier parts in the book, which, you know, are those standalone comics, are just that, you know, there's the page, that's what it is, that's all it is. It reminds me of those single strip Family Circus comics.
Sure. Yeah. And I mean, I was inspired by a lot of that when I was a kid. I got a collection of comic strips from my grandparents. It was the Smithsonian collection of newspaper comic strips. So I saw all of the old classics, Pogo and Captain Easy and Dick Tracy and Peanuts. So I've always been very inspired by that. And the other main, I think, influence behind Mr. Breadchips is the underground comics of the 60s and 70s. So people like Robert Crumb, Spain Rodriguez, and my favorite is probably Gilbert Shelton, who did the fabulous Furry Freak Brothers. And they have an animated series coming out soon, so that'll be pretty cool. But I think those two sort of separate influences are what came together to create Mr. Butterchips.
And one of the things I remember reading in the foreword was, here's this little asshole monkey doing his little asshole monkey things, and all of a sudden, oh shit, I connect with this character.
Right. Yeah, and that's hopefully what happens. It's deceptively relatable, hopefully, where he's talking about issues and societal ills that I think we all face and we all are a little frustrated with at this point. So while it's through the veneer of this cartoon monkey, hopefully there are some little nuggets of truth in there too that people can find and relate to in there. So hope anyway.
Which part of it have you heard most from people is where they really start having that connection?
It's honestly, I think it's after reading through a few. So that was part of the idea behind collecting them all in one place. Is if you just read a few, it's just kind of this hostile, abrasive monkey screaming about whatever happens to be on his mind at that time. But the more you read, I think the clearer it becomes that he's not just ranting about absolutely nothing. He's actually talking about real issues. And I think that's when people tend to start realizing that it's not just a farce. It's not just this ridiculous comic strip. It's actually touching on some real issues.
I mean, I got to the part where the artist's head is exploding and then Mr. Butterchip steps out of the page.
Right. Yeah, the very meta.
And that little two-page spread was really what hit it for me with this being a super relatable character.
Oh, cool. Yeah, that's awesome. It was sort of my who is it, Garth Ennis moment where he sort of entered his own book, and that was sort of something that influenced me to do that, or inspired me rather, and to have sort of a moment where it was Mr. Butterchips talking to me to show people. And I think that did maybe humanize him, for lack of a better word. Like you said, that was something that a lot of people responded to in that way.
And one of the other things that I've really liked here is it steps on a lot of, I almost hate to say political things because, with the way the world is going right now, but a lot of things that have become political, which basically in my mind and from what I understand your mind too, from talking to you before we started recording, of, just the general don't be an asshole.
And that's kind of the thing I think that struck a lot of us in this day and age, where it sort of transcends politics at this point, and it just becomes an ethical debate or a debate about morality. Putting children in cages is wrong. Lynching members of the black community is wrong. It doesn't have anything to do with politics anymore. It just has to do with being a good person or not. And there's really no gray area in a lot of those aspects. So, Mr. Butterchips actually started as an homage to those underground comics that I had previously mentioned. But after the 2016 election, when the country started becoming super polarized, the comic took a really sharp left turn into that kind of commentary. So, I sort of, say it's a political satire or it's a political strip. But again, for me, it's really more about ethical you know, substance than anything else, or ethical character, considering most of this country, or a lot of this country, seems to be morally bankrupt at this point, regardless of your political affiliation.
I mean, it's hard to keep politics completely out of anything anyway.
Well, it is. You know, with the 24-hour news cycle and all of the stories hitting us at, you know, every second of every day, it's near impossible, if not completely impossible, to completely lock that sort of influence out of your life completely.
So what has it been like for you making a webcomic versus, like, a more traditional on paper printed comic?
I think one of the reasons I started doing the webcomics was I had a little bit more control over the content to begin with. And the other thing was you had a little bit more control over the audience that you're catering to or that you're targeting. And the editors that I've worked with and the publishers that I've worked with, while sort of small operations, have, you know, basically allowed me to do whatever I wanted to, you know, save for going too far, or not that I would be racist or homophobic, but I'm sure if it was something like that, they wouldn't be as accommodating, or at least I would hope not. And I think when you sign with a publisher, and I've worked with publishers before, they want a little bit more control. They want to have their fingerprints on it a little bit more than the editors and publishers that I've worked with. So having the webcomic was a bit of creative freedom, but it was also a way for me to sort of hone those storytelling skills, because before 2015, which is when I started the first webcomic, Decades of Inexperience, which came about a year before Mr. Butterchips, I wasn't really focused on any one specific thing. I was pitching shows for animated networks. I was playing music. I was doing all of these, you know, vastly different endeavors that were all creative, but also they all required a full-time commitment. So in 2015, I sort of decided to laser focus on one sort of field where I figured my skill set best fit, and that happened to be comics. So it's been a really fertile sort of training ground to, you know, sort of sharpen those skills a bit.
I know you said earlier that you've lettered the whole thing and you've drawn the whole thing and mm-hmm. written the whole thing. How tempted have you been throughout the process to get somebody else to do part of that?
Well, there are other stories where I think I would want another artist to draw them, possibly. I've tried working with other writers, and typically the ones that I've worked with anyways have wanted to be a little bit too involved with the artwork, but not allow me to have any say so on the story, even if I found some things problematic or tried to edit it a little bit for them. So for me, doing it on my own was just a way of having sort of control over everything. I'm a little OCD, so I kind of needed to be, you know, rule with an iron fist kind of thing. And I would definitely work with other people. I would definitely collaborate if the project called for it. But for Decades and Mr. Butterchips, those are definitely two things that I have felt very comfortable doing on my own.
No, I definitely understand that. There's a reason why I don't let anybody else edit this podcast.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I let my wife edit one or two, and that was it.
And I think wife input supersedes a lot of, you know, like, outside contributors, you know, because my wife will edit a lot of my scripts too, or I like to let her edit them. She was an English major, so she's actually helped my writing quite a bit as well. And I think when you're in that kind of a relationship, that doesn't quite count as the same kind of you know, wall that you're putting up, I guess, to outside contributors. And at least for me, it doesn't qualify as the same sort of category.
No, I'm definitely with you on that one.
Yeah. Happy wife, happy life, right?
Exactly. I mean, it goes the other way too, but it doesn't rhyme.
No, It doesn't rhyme, but it is all about a partnership. And I think there are certain concessions to that, and not necessarily bad ones. But if you're letting somebody into your life like that, that includes your creative pursuits, your outside pursuits as well. And it's important to have individual identities, but, you know, my storytelling and my comics are something that I really enjoy sharing with the person that I love.
What kind of surprises me with connecting to this character is that the Chris Cornell page is not what really did it for me.
Interesting.
Like, I'm not saying I don't like it. It's just, for whatever reason, that isn't what made me say, oh shit, I really love this character.
Right. But you love Chris Cornell.
Oh, yeah.
Well, and to be fair, that specific installment carried a little bit of a different message than just celebrating Chris Cornell. So I suppose you can chalk it up to that to some degree, because it was, you know, pretty heavily talking about just suicide and you know, reaching out to people if you ever have those thoughts and things of that nature. And Chris Cornell was just sort of the catalyst for that when he took his own life, for me. And I think, you know, to your point, a lot of people might be drawn in by that, to that specific entry, because Chris Cornell's a part of it. But it's certainly not about Chris Cornell, so that may be where the misfire was a little bit.
Well, really, the thing that surprises me isn't so much Chris Cornell, because there are so many people it could have been. But sure. The suicide aspect of things is something I've dealt with. So it just surprises me that wasn't, okay, now I can take this thing completely seriously.
Yeah, and I think Mr. Butterchips has that sort of aesthetic to him, where, again, some of it is outlandish and cartoonish and played up for effect, but there are some real issues and real subjects, serious subjects, that he's tackling as well. Well, he and I talk about him like he's a different person. And I think that's where people tend to be, you know, be drawn in, like you said.
So where would you say that line is between you and Mr. Butterchips being the same person or not?
I kind of recently, because SLG was kind of asking where Mr. Butterchips sprang from, and I had somebody else ask me where, you know, kind of a similar question, how much of my personality was in Mr. Butterchips. And my answer to that is typically he's kind of my id unleashed, to, you know, to paraphrase Freud. So he's just this no filter, you know, running commentary peanut section on life. And if I didn't have a filter or tact, that's probably who I would be.
I mean, there's definitely worse people you could be.
There are definitely worse people. And, you know, I think if Mr. Butterchips was real, he might be easy to, you know, take in small doses. I don't know that he'd be somebody you'd want to be around all the time, though. And hopefully that's a differentiation between him and me, where I hope people want to spend time with me, because I feel like Mr. Butterchips would turn groups of people off very quickly.
What are your plans for Mr. Butterchips going forward?
For the time being, at least, I'm going to continue the monthly installments with Drunk Monkeys and just kind of continue to progress with the character in that realm. And if SLG is open to it, we might do another book. We haven't discussed that much further than very tentative plans. But I would love to continue doing the character, at least for a little while. And I, you know, even after this year's election, regardless of the outcome, I don't think there's going to be any shortage of material anytime soon.
Oh, no, not at all.
No. So it will be a pretty easy strip to continue. And I think the long form stuff is really interesting to do with him, like the, you know, 22 page story in the book. So it may be an avenue to explore for me in the future as well. But for now, he's indefinitely going to continue the monthly strips on the Drunk Monkey site.
And if people want to check out more from you, what other things do you have out there that they can go find?
The aforementioned Decades of Inexperience, which was the first webcomic I started in 2015, that is published by an online outfit called Antexpress and edited by a guy named Francis Lombard, who has also, you know, aside from my wife, has also been a huge help in developing my writing skills. So there's Decades of Inexperience, Mr. Butterchips, and I signed with a literary agent last year, actually a little over a year ago at this point. I think it was April 2019. So we've been pitching some graphic novel ideas, and fingers crossed, one of those will get picked up. And there's a few other things, a few other irons in the fire that aren't really things that I can talk about yet, but those are the main ones that I'm working on. And the ones that can be read are certainly Decades of Inexperience and the Butterchips book, or and online strips as well.
And if people want to just follow you personally, where is the best place for that?
Unfortunately, social media has become a necessity in this day and age, especially for creative people. So I'm on the Twitters, I'm on Instagram. Both of those are at AJ Schumacher Art, so pretty easy because both of the handles are the same. I also have my personal website, which is just alexschumacherart.com, all kind of in the same, you know, realm. So pretty easy to remember. And social media is just such a beast, but it is unfortunately something that all creative people have to contend with at this point. It's, if you're not online, people just aren't going to find you. That the entire model of distribution has shifted so drastically, just even in the past 5 years. It's kind of insane to try and keep up with everything. Because I know there's, you know, there's even like TikTok, and there's different things that develop, or you know, different platforms that pop up all the time. But Twitter and Instagram, I'm mainly on. I've sort of, for all intents and purposes, ditched Facebook. I mean, I say it's evil, but of course, Instagram is owned by Facebook, so I'm sort of a hypocrite. But aren't we all to some degree?
Yeah, pretty much.
But those are the main ones. I'm on Twitter and Instagram, and I actually find myself posting more than I intend to, and kind of end up loathing myself. But again, it's a necessary evil these days, so I'm okay with doing it. And if it garners some sort of audience and following, which it has to some degree, and I'm incredibly thankful for the people that do read my work, it's worth it just for that alone.
I mean, it's probably the best and the worst thing possible that I can get on Twitter and ask one of my favorite authors which one of their books I should read next.
No, absolutely. And I've found that even very prominent, well-known, you know, creators, politicians, personalities, a lot of them will actually respond directly to you. And I know in some cases it's probably an assistant or something, but I know for a fact there's been a few that have actually been the person who's reaching out to their fan base. And I think that's a really interesting way to not only connect with the art, but connect with the person, because, you know, those are one and the same as far as I'm concerned. And, you know, that's why it's been so troubling, especially recently, to find out about a lot of the abuse that's been going on. Cause I know some people can compartmentalize and separate between the art and the artist, but that's very difficult for me. So having something like Twitter where you can actually interact with the person is very cool. And I love it when people reach out to me too. Not that it happens on any kind of incredibly frequent basis, but when they do, I'm very appreciative that people would even think to do that. And I'm happy to chat with people. It's an accessibility. That's what it is. It's an accessibility that wasn't available before.
And I like knowing that the artists that I'm supporting are not horrible people.
Like, absolutely.
I've definitely gone to my comic shop and told them, hey, this thing that I've kind of been talking to you about for months that I'm really excited about, yeah, I'm not getting it anymore because this person's a horrible person.
Yeah. Garbage person is creating this. Take it off my pull list.
Garbage company is being straight garbage. Just take their entire publishing thing off my pull list.
Yeah, or that. And I know, you know, for a fact, SLG Publishing and the president, Dan Votto, are stand-up, very cool people who defend, you know, diversity and different voices and marginalized people. And not that Mr. Butterchips is necessarily that, but I have heard many stories and testimonials from people in the industry that he's done that in the past. And that was one of the things that solidified my choice to go with them. Even though they're not quite as active as they used to be, they're still quite a name in the industry. And, you know, again, like we're talking about, to know that he's also a really good guy and that the company has launched the career of a lot of diverse voices, it makes me very happy to be a small part of that.
Well, maybe I need to see if I can get one of them on the show.
Yeah, I don't think they would mind. I mean, they started people like Yonan Vasquez, who is best known for Invader Zim at this point, but he started with comics, and that and those books were published by SLG.
Well, SLG, get somebody ready, because I'm going to figure out how to get somebody from the publishing place on the show.
I think I could probably make that connection for you if you are interested.
Sweet, let's do it.
Grease the wheels for you, as it were.
Good, because I'm being completely serious.
No, I'm sure Dan would do that. He's a really easy to talk to guy and accommodating. So I think if he was able to find time, that would probably be the one holdup, is if he had a packed schedule. But I'm sure he'd be more than happy to talk to you about setting something up. So I'll put that in motion for you.
Well, sweet, because it's not like there's anything else going on right now.
Not at all. Nothing. No.
All right, well, we will have links to all of your stuff down in the show notes, because that's so much easier than trying to figure out how to spell things.
Absolutely. And my last name is definitely sort of a minefield for people. So I think putting them in the show notes is kind of the best to practice.
Which is weird, because I had no problem spelling your last name at all.
Oh, that's awesome.
I can get it.
Well, then you and I are officially best friends.
Oh, that's so fun. Cool, we're going to do it.
Nice.
Gelato ice cream sandwiches for days.
Sweet. I'm down. Let's go on a sugar high and write a bunch of comics.
Well, I mean, you guys heard it here first. We're going to have super insane comics.
Inspired by sugar highs and ice cream sandwiches. There's really nothing wrong with that.
There's a place over here that does, I realize we're getting way off the track of the show now, but there's a place in Charleston that does gelato ice cream sandwiches on pancakes.
Oh man, you might have to FedEx me some of those. Just pack them with some dry ice and get them over here.
If I could figure out how to do it, I would, because they'd be worth it.
I can imagine. It's my mouth is watering as we're talking about it. I'm sure Mr. Butterchips would like that too. That could be written into a comic, I think. Yeah. That goes well with bourbon, I'm sure.
Oh, it does. I mean, I'll have to ask my wife where it is, because it's one of those places that I can't ever remember the name of, but I know how to get there when I'm walking around downtown.
Sure. After a few cocktails, probably, that sort of brings it all back to you.
Oh, exactly.
You know, yeah.
Because that's what happens downtown.
Yes, the drunk recall. Like, you know where all the good munchy spots are, but only if you're drunk.
Well, on that crazy note, we're going to go ahead and close things out. Otherwise, we're going to be here forever.
That's true.
So, Alex, it's been great finally catching you for this. I know we've been talking about this for months, and life just kind of kept happening.
It does, man. It definitely happens right now. And I was kind of getting the book stuff ready, and there were, I mean, I'm sure you had plenty of things going on too, but I am glad we connected, and it's, you know, my pleasure, and thank you for having me on the show.
Well, you're welcome, and when you have something else to come out and talk about it, we can certainly do that again, or maybe we can get you on a regular episode sometime.
No, that'd be great. I'd be happy to. We'll definitely stay in touch.
All right, so until then, everybody, just grab a game, grab a stack of comics, and go find yourself a new favorite character.
Hell yeah.